Dr. Carlos Castillo-Chavez from Arizona State University, where he is a Regents Professor, a Joaquin Bustos Jr., Professor of Mathematical Biology. He is a director or executive director of several research institutes, including the Simon A. Levin Mathematical Computational Modeling Sciences Center. Really a long list of prestigious awards and appointments, but let's get to the talk since we're running a little behind already. Please welcome Dr. Castillo-Chavez. He will speak to us about beyond Ebola, Dengue, Influenza and Zika, lessons learned for mitigating future pandemics.
Thank you very much for having me here, and particularly the applied math group that they have already taken me twice to a Mexican restaurant, and that's heaven for me. I'm gonna give you some ideas, some of the things that one does and where they come from. So I work on the field that involve essentially host-parasite interactions. And that could be epidemiology, could be immunology. So many biological processes are of that type. And particularly, what kind of questions you ask depends on the level of organization that you look at. So for example, you can be looking at the population of interacting cells, then you're working in the field of immunology. You are looking at the level of interaction between diseases like influenza at the population level, then you can be looking at the level of a population or a community or different levels. So where does this field all started? And it started by Sir Ronald Ross, which in 1902 got the second Nobel Award in medicine. And he did it by discovering, just what it is in this little clip, of how malaria was transmitted. So at that time, they didn't know that the life cycle of the parasite involves life stages within the vector, the mosquito, and within the human. So why was he there? And then the general idea, so now he was looking at the question at a particular level of organization, right? How does influenza comes about? And he understood that it had to be with what happened within two hosts, the mosquitoes and the humans. So now I understand that. So now the next question is, okay, now I understand that. If I'm a doctor, my job is to figure out how I can ameliorate the problems associated with malaria within a single individual. Right? And that's great, now I discovered this. I got the Nobel Prize. So the question that he says, now that I understand that, how can I ameliorate or diminish the impact of malaria at the level of a community, at the level of a region, at the level of the country, at the global level? That's a different question. Now that I understand what are the mechanisms of transmission from vector to host, how can I use that information? How much of that information do I need to address these questions at a higher level of organization? And this is precisely where mathematical models play a big role. We can study processes at some particular levels, and then we want to understand how, when we understand at some particular level, how can we apply that information, or how much of that information we need to answer questions at higher and higher or more complex levels of organization. So that's what we do. We cannot do a big experiment and release malaria all over the world and see who gets it and who transmits it. We can't possibly do that, right? So you want to do that. So that's what he did. And in order to do that, he developed this mathematical model. And this is a very interesting mathematical model. In this case, X is the proportion of infected mosquitoes, and Y is the proportion of infected mosquitoes. And essentially, he wrote this particular equation, and these are mechanistic equations. Typically, when you have data, some information, you write a statistical model, you do regression, you do something like that, and you might find some association between some terms, and say, well, possibly there is some connection between them. But when you write a mechanistic model, you are actually proposing what are the mechanisms for those interactions. So you actually know the parameters actually have a direct context. So in this case, for example, some of the things that he discovered is entering into place, the ratio between host and vector should be important. if there is a lot of mosquitoes per person, we have some problem, you have less, you have another problem. Then he said, well, dividing rate, it should be important, right? And also, you know, the probability of transmission. Well, they bite you, not always they pass you malaria, but if the mosquito is infected, with some probability they will pass the malaria. The recovery rate is important because people don't have the disease, and the death rate of the mosquitoes. What is the average lifespan of the mosquitoes? For example, in tropical areas where a lot of these diseases survive, the mosquitoes live for a long period of time, right? If you go, for example, to Wisconsin, where the state bird is the mosquito, okay, then you do realize that you don't have malaria because they don't live very long. So there are very issues associated with that. Okay, so let me just summarize. So once he had discovered the Nobel, once he had received the Nobel Prize in malaria, he had a different idea. Now how can I use this for the public good? So the question he asked, can malaria be controlled at the community or population or regional or national or global levels? That's the general idea. So this becomes something that is very, very important in interdisciplinary research and where mathematics, statistics, computational methods plays a central role. How do we use individual transmission knowledge to explain disease patterns at the population or the community level? Right? And then the other ones, did mathematics help? Actually, like every good scientist, and almost every good scientist, already knows the answer before he or she addresses the question. So she said, how can we actually address the problem of malaria? And he concluded that all you have to do is to bring the population of mosquitoes below some level. You don't have to eliminate it, but below some level. So he made this proposal, but they didn't believe him. So he wrote some mathematical models to prove actually that that was a feasible answer. And when he proposed that was a feasible answer, that was the work, that's the work that he received. But there was more associated with that, right? In his paper, 1911, he did something very, very important that a lot of mathematics departments will reject. But it's really very critical. When you're doing interdisciplinary research, even if you do very interesting mathematics of some kind, or very interesting application, if you are actually interested in interdisciplinary research, the key part is, this is the scientific question, this is what I found out. No, I happen to find this characteristic equation and all this. No, you want to publish, you can publish that separately, but that's the important part, and that's what makes it very difficult to publish. And then if and then the technical details are put in an appendix. So some of the most incredible mathematical appendices you find in the Journal of Animal Ecology, where people have done some very interesting studies of functional differential equations, but many people don't read them because they don't have to. They want to know what was the result of doing that, and others that are interested in the modeling and other aspects, they look at them. So the general idea, in his paper, he did many things. He said, by the way, these mathematical models can also be used to study the transmission dynamics of sexually transmitted diseases. It took 50 or 60 years later, before two mathematicians, the late Kenneth Hook and Jim York. Jim York is the guy that introduced the word chaos. It's a very well-known pure mathematician that wrote this famous paper, Period 3 implies chaos, with a Chinese colleague. So the question is, can this be, so they actually applied and they wrote the first model assistant of integral equations to study the dynamics of gonorrhea. And that was good. But much later, also Jim York and Herbert Hector from the University of Iowa, they wrote the most fundamental paper in the study of sexually transmitted. And let me tell you, it had almost no analysis. They had great mathematicians, because the math analysis was difficult. It was done with no data, because there was no data. But essentially, they went and addressed the issue of how gonorrhea was controlled. And in that time, what they did is, every time a woman went to have a pap test, without telling her often, they had a gonorrhea test. And they had a gonorrhea test because a lot of women that have gonorrhea are asymptomatic. So they wanted to prevent that. Well, men are not asymptomatic, so if they get gonorrhea, they know that they have gonorrhea, so they go and get treated. So what they concluded, this is a really not very smart way of doing it. We're essentially doing random testing, and most people don't have gonorrhea. So what they did is they said, let's assume that there is a small group of individuals, right, that have way too many sexual partners, and that therefore they are more likely to be the most people likely to get gonorrhea and transmit gonorrhea. They call this the core group. Why the core group? Because Jim York likes words with C. I like Jim because I'm CCC, so this is. So anyway, so he looks at the core group, and then what they concluded, suppose there is a small group that they're highly sexually active, and then they concluded that if you focus in identifying and treating the core group, you reduce the cost by a factor of 20. This is without knowing the cost, without having any data, without doing anything. So in the 90s, I used to go to the health department in Albany because I used to be a professor at Cornell. I was there for 18 years. And they have a little map of the sexually transmitted clinics. And when there is an outbreak of gonorrhea, they send, so to speak, the troops. They identify the usual suspects. They treat them. And that's the way it works out. And there are many studies. Big outbreaks of gonorrhea in high schools, and they go, and most of the cases can be traced to very few individuals, okay? So that's the way they did. Is that the only contribution that they did? And that was the most important paper in gonorrhea that changed national policy, completely changed national policy. In the 90s, there was another important contribution by Ed Kaplan, and what he did is he applied the same ideas, much more creative modeling, but the same ideas to study the dynamics of intravenous drug HIV, intravenous transmitted drug HIV. And what he did essentially is to study the dynamics of transmissions among drug users and the syringes, right? So what he introduced is the idea that if you provided a program of exchange needles, that they would actually reduce the transmission of essentially of HIV. Now, this became very controversial. Some people say you give more needles, there will be more drug transmission. There is always, also for issues associated with that or with anything that has to do with sexually transmitted diseases, drug diseases, whatever proposal you may become very controversial because people have different ideas of what is might be right or might not be wrong. Now, I think that these questions are good. I'm not saying that these questions, but I think it's very imperative that the people that are doing the research actually prove that one method is much better than the alternative. And if they can do that, then all these questions remain valid. The problem is when they show that some method works and is really effective, and they continue to oppose, that's exactly when the problems come. So somebody might have actually shown that the introduction of a change needle program, in fact, increased the number of HIV cases, and in that case, that should not be allowed, right? But in this case, what they did, they actually did it, and he created that in New Haven, what is Yale. He's a professor at Yale University. It's a small campus, and he actually went and produced and showed that his program worked. And it was a very sophisticated program because the population of needles changed. And then when they exchanged needles, they had to be tested for HIV and so forth. So it was a very sophisticated program, and after he did this program, and evaluated, and they have the mayor of the city involved and all the authorities involved, they actually proved that through this program that cost $150,000, they saved two lives. Now, some people, might say, well, it's a life worth $75,000. I say it's worth a lot more. But they actually saved two lives. But more importantly, they showed that the program worked. The mayor of New York City found this interesting, so they called them. And they went to New York City, and they gave this presentation. They were reluctant. But after some debate, they said, well, okay, let's put it into place. And in New York City, it saved 2,000 lives, okay? So it is a sophisticated process, it's a literature papers, and now it has been put into place in many places. In Europe, for example, different cultures, they put this program without question. They assume that they work. I think it's important to show that they actually work. All right, so now I'm going to go now a little bit to communicable diseases. That's the other area of infectious disease that I'm interested. Typically, there are some simple models that everybody probably has seen, people that study epidemiology. Essentially, what you do is you want to study an epidemic process, right? And in order to get some epidemic transmission, you have to be close or interact with somebody that has the disease in general. And so initially, if none of you have influenza, and I come from Arizona and I have influenza, and I start shaking hands with everybody, and then some people put their hands to the mouth and things like that, then I might start an outbreak of influenza. I hope not. I was vaccinated, so I hope that's not the case. But that's the way it goes. So there's general idea that there is the introduction of a person that is infected in a population of susceptibles that might generate an outbreak. Now, how do you do this mathematically? Well, you can do it in simple ways and assume that everybody's the same, and that's sort of the simplest model. But you can assume also that there is a lot of heterogeneity. For example, right? I come here, I'm most likely to greet, you know, professors, right? If I was a student, I'm most likely to spend time with the students. So the way these experiments are carried out is by mathematically describing what is a typical individual in the population. So what is a typical individual in this population? If I look around, it's probably somebody that has maybe 22 years old, is good looking, and let me see, and I say maybe it is 33% female, right? That would be a typical person in this population. So that, how would you discuss, and then you infect a typical person, which is just a mathematical construct, then you put it in the population, and then you see what are the conditions for that person to generate, to infect more than one person, since it's an average 1.1 person, two persons, before he or she recovers. In this case, it, because who knows what it is, a typical person, right? And in that case, then essentially, we have that person, after that person recovers, it leaves more than one infected, and then each one of them leaves more, and it continues to grow exponentially, right? But then, we start running out of people, right? It's like people are the resource. So essentially, exponential growth starts to slow down, and eventually, it sort of disappears. So that's an outbreak of influenza, right? So its growth exponential starts to slow down and eventually disappears because it runs out of resources, or you are trying to infect people that are already recovered. Okay? And there are many things that you can prove. You can prove that not everybody gets the disease, for example. You can actually prove that. Anyway, but you know, they study now some of that even in calculus classes. Now they study that. Anyway, but there are other people that want to study communities. So this is an example of the city of Portland, and what they model is a city that has 1.5 million people running around. And then they model the people, and they know, for example, it is my kid coming to work, just across the bridge, the one they run. 5 o'clock in the morning, he's the first one in the office. Okay. And so for us, we know everything, we know how much he makes, how many children he has, everything. This is not a simulation. But the general idea, and I go back to the previous slide, is in this, we are modeling this community. So essentially, there is 1.5 million people moving in this community. How do they move? Well, they did a survey of, it might have cost $30 million, and they asked people, what do they do, and at what time do they do it? So at night they might be at home, then they get up, they go to school, take the kids, do this, go to work, et cetera, at 6 o'clock you do this, at 6:05 you do this, at 6:10 you do this, somebody get up at 7, and so you develop a series of schedules, then you build a synthetic population that reflects the characteristics of Portland, and then you give them schedules, and then you see the movement between 180,000 locations. And if there are no college students, right, at midnight everybody's sleeping, okay, but after a while people start to get up and go in the morning, and they start to move. Most of the 180,000 places are disconnected, but eventually they start to connect. And a dynamic network starts to get created, right? It's not a scale-free network, it's not a small world network, it's not a, you know, mathematical network, it's a real network. It starts to be created, right? And different parts of the networks get connected, right? And they connected, and the strength of the connection changes with time. It's not just I connect this node with this node by an arrow. Right? There is a flux. If many people go from this place to that place, the flux increases and increases. We can actually look at these networks conditioned on activities. say, what is the structure of this network over time, from midnight to midnight, right? Every second, based on social activities. Going to bars, dancing, going to dinner, whatever. What is condition on working activities? What is conditions on different kinds of activities? What is condition on all activities, or all activities minus one? And in all of these, you can study the structure of the network. And you get some power laws, but you don't get any of the standard power laws, and they change over time. And if you look at the power laws that you generate over all activities, and then you subtract one, you can even have some hierarchical models, and technically you could do some connection between the exponents and actually do some inferences. That part we didn't do, but the structure of the network, we did a study, and we have, and that's a paper that we published with my former student, and that was published in 2003. So this is the case of the networks. Now, these networks were built so to study the movement of people, the general idea. If we understand what people do, can we design better cities to save energy? This was done early after one of the first oil embargoes. That's when the idea came up. And now that these networks are here, the next question is, can we use them to study epidemics? And here is an epidemic of influenza. And in that side, this is a side where an epidemic of influenza is ongoing, and everybody's like, well, so what? If I catch influenza, they continue to do the same thing. In this case, 75% of the people take some kinds of precautions, right? They might wear masks, or they stop kissing each other, or shaking hands with everybody, and they just watch out for a while. And in both cases, you get the same epidemic, but the scale is different. You get epidemics in every way. But if you look at that model that you have there, that's exactly the same figures that you get with the simplest possible model. Now, what I'm trying to say, why am I trying to say this? Well, there is this overvalue activity in my perspective that says, okay, can you fit that model to data? And the answer, perfectly. Not that I can do perfect fit. In fact, anybody can do a perfect fit. Can I fit an epidemic model? Yes, the simplest one. What would the parameters mean? Nothing. They would be used as a feeding parameters. Even though I'm having a mechanistic model and I'm making a perfect fit and I can make perfect predictions, right? Doesn't mean anything, right? That the aggregate model has a particular figure and the simplest model has the same dynamics tells me something about the interactions and the fact that it is good. But you know, but in terms of what can I learn from that model and what the parameters mean, not a lot. So sometimes people say, I fit the model to data, okay. And in biology, sometimes they put too much emphasis on that. It is useful for many things, but one has to be very clear for what and for what not. And that's very, very important. So for example, what can we learn from this model that would not be in the parameters? One of the things that one learns from that model is there are schools, there are different places that most of the secondary cases of infection, in other words, somebody gets infected and passes to other people, most of the secondary cases of infections take place at home. Now, you talk to many epidemiologists and they say, no, they take place at school. No, it's at home. Are the schools critical nodes? Yes. Right? But if nobody went to schools, that would not be a critical node, but then probably everybody could go to the shopping malls, and the shopping malls would become a critical node. The point is that we make a lot of measures based on schools, right? And we almost never tell people to be careful at home. And that's where the most cases of infections are going on. And I have a simulation, by the way, of 300 million people in the United States that gives exactly the same result, 300 million people. Anyway, another of the issues that are very important is the role of behavior. And the role of behavior is difficult to explain, right? The general idea is when you try to figure out about behavior, everybody has some idea. And if it was that simple, well, then the problem would be solved. But understanding behavior and human behavior is very complicated because it is tied in about how people make decisions. So we're making some efforts. In fact, we published a paper in 2011 in PNS based upon some ideas that we spent discussing with economists for several years. And the reason is that every time I talk with an economist, I understand less. Well, but I learned something. I learned the word trade-off. Okay, so So he said, what, you know, everything is about trade-offs, then everybody thinks that I know economics. Okay, and that's the trade-off, I guess. Anyway, but the general idea is that according to economists, and I like that approach, is people make decisions not in what you think that makes it big, but because on what they value, right? If I'm very, very sick, am I gonna run a marathon? Probably not if I value my health more than running the marathon, right? So that's a decision. If I'm healthy, well, yes, even though that's gonna be a very stressful decision, right? So the decisions are made based on what you value and the cost function associated with your state. In the case of influenza, for example, right? Many people, they get, or you know, any kind of childhood disease, the man gets up, the little kid has temperature, she's a single mother, she cannot afford to lose a day of work, so she brings the temperature down of the kid, takes it to the daycare center, drops it in there, and they say, oh, see you, very quickly disappears, goes to work, arrives to work, and she says, if they call me, tell them that I'm not here, that you don't know what I'm doing. And then 2 hours later, they call, you know, your kid is sick, she needs to pick it up, we don't know where she is. At 3 o'clock, the man shows up to school, oh, I'm so sorry, I just found out, because blah, blah, right? Why? Because she can't afford to lose a day of pay. And it happens a lot, okay? So you said people, actually, they will knew, well, depends on what they value the most, right? And so there is a lot of decisions that people take on that situation. So how do we have modeled this? Well, we have modeled this, for example, is we have modeled epidemics, and then we make decisions people based on the state, and we use stochastic dynamic programming. We have some finite time horizon. So people have some information on their state, and based upon that, they make a decision, right? And then you update their status, right? And then you move the time frame, right? And then now they have additional information, and then you update, and then using a stochastic program, you can actually trace what is the impact of behavioral decisions on an epidemic outbreak. And what do you find out? That the epidemics are less severe and they grow a lot less. Invariable. Okay. So this is an important decision, so we have worked on that. So here is a caricature, because I didn't want to talk about that. And in this case, it's special espresso disease. You can think of this sort of Ebola if you want, or you can think of this mostly probably of leprosy. Okay, come on. So in this case, you have S is the susceptible individuals, I are infectious but with no symptoms, and I too, they have symptoms. So when people have symptoms in leprosy, right, you avoid them. You are too young, but there was a movie, Dengue, where they separated all the people with leprosy, so that would report that. And what we put there, this is not a mechanistic model, this is a phenomenological model. You can make it mechanistically, but the questions get more complicated, more difficult to explain. So you see, as the number of people with symptoms grow, people start avoiding everybody. Okay? I'm worried about that. So you see people with symptoms, you start. And what happens when you do that? Well, in that particular case, you obtain something called diffusive instability, and you actually generate patterns where their own types seem to aggregate with each other. So just naturally, if people have symptoms and you don't have any treatment and cure, it's going to happen that way. In the case of Ebola in West Africa, that's exactly what would have happened, except, right, that in many towns, the army came and closed the towns, and people couldn't leave. Okay? So now people are dying on your village, you have to leave them, your children get sick, what do you do? Okay? I'll get back to that story. But anyway, that's the story. So I run a summer program for undergraduates for the last 20 years. And you can see the technical reports that they have. There's 180 of them online. I think I put the website online, but I forget. And out of that, hundreds of publications have come out. Now, what is the interesting part about this undergraduate program is that the faculty don't choose the problems. So, and the graduates come from all parts of the country, and they decide what to study. Okay, so it's a So what do the faculty find out and what do the students learn from that? Well, the first thing that comes immediate to the students is, yeah, this professor is not that smart. If you ask them something about something that they don't know, they are not really that great. And that's absolutely true. And very important, right? You know, if I start talking to you in Spanish and you get impressed, there is a problem, right? And you start talking to me in Chinese and I get impressed, there is a problem, right? Why is that? Well, because you are an expert Chinese speaker and I'm an expert, well, maybe not so much, a Spanish speaker, right? That doesn't make me smarter than you or vice versa, right? So if we want to prove how good we are for languages, right? Okay, let somebody talk to us in Russian and let's see how much we understand. That's the model. So the student chooses the questions. So that changes the hierarchy, right? And when it changes the hierarchy, that means that now we have to work with each other and now we become partners, right? And now we really listen to what the students have to say. And sometimes I say, no, 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 Carlos, that's really stupid. Well, they don't say that. But they don't use that word, but they might say something like that. Or it should be very clear. And it's absolutely true, you know? You just scramble, you don't know what to do. So some people have studied the impact of alcohol on the brain. Where do you start? Imagine I'm working to my topology professor. I want to study the impact of alcohol in the brain. Say, are you okay? Are you in the right building? Should I call the doctor, right? I mean, that's what happened, right? Well, does mathematics play a role there? Of course it does. Now, I don't know, I don't have any idea. That's a research question, right? Am I interested in helping you? Maybe not because I'm busy or whatever it is, right? But I should not dismiss that problem as an unimportant just because I don't know what to do. As you said, you know, that's a good question. I have no idea what to do. I will have to start from scratch. And the student might say, okay, let's start from scratch. Well, I'm sorry, I have children and car payments and conferences and teach classes. But that's a good question. But we shouldn't dismiss that question because we have no expertise. So the rules here is they talk about whatever they want. So in 1996, the first year of the program, some students work on Ebola. Had no idea what it was. And in 1999, other group decided to work on Ebola. No idea why they decided, but the students were interested. And most of the time, they're interested in things like crime, violence, environmental issues, pollution, things that you cannot write a simple equation and address it, so things are really complicated. And you can see the results on the web. I urge you to go to those. We trained them for 3 months, for 3 weeks, in some basic computational and modeling approaches, and then they work on these projects for 3.5 weeks. And what they do is simply amazing. It's simply amazing. And these are on the classes. I urge you to see this, because the first thing that you're gonna do that, if you collaborate, and if you choose the questions, and if you are passionate about those, you're gonna do something amazing. Well beyond what you would do otherwise, okay? So that's one of the things that we do. So this, in 2004, this is first paper appeared from that, and that was the first estimate of the rate of growth of Ebola. That's sometimes called the basic reproductive number. Two, that means that one case generates two, then each case generates two, so it's a branching process. So that was the only estimate, and we had confidence intervals. And so that paper that had maybe 20 citations now has over 200 citations because of that. And we know everything about Ebola. You have heard it, you know. Poor region, bad systems, porous borders, lots of problems. And when we started looking at Ebola, it was around here. And then people say, because we have done this in the past, can we do something about this? What can we do about that? And that's all the data that you have. And so about it. Well, we need a lot more data. Well, yeah, you can always do better with more data. One of the challenges about modeling and contributing is what you do with the data that you have. And you say, well, I need more data. Well, yes, I need a new car and a nice house. And we need a lot of things, right? But you want to contribute, you have to work with the things that you have. And how do you become great? So the first thing that you are here, see? The simplest thing that you try to look at the rate of growth. Right? Because that's what can happen. Well, somebody, that's really simple. I think, like, well, what else could you possibly do with this? well, nothing complicated, therefore I'm not getting involved, but this is an important problem. Okay. So we started looking at the greater growth of this, and we published a paper on that. This is a student from Cuba that he was a student, now he's a postdoc at Harvard. And Sherry is my colleague. And we wrote at this, and we estimated the rate of growth, but then something strange, we found out something strange. Well, number one, we found out that the rate of growth, remember I told you, it starts growing exponentially, but then it starts less and less. In this case, it keeps getting bigger. So because it can get bigger, we estimated more cases than we thought they should be. And when there was the SARS epidemic in Canada, we predicted no more than 400 cases way before, and there was 396. Is that a successful prediction? Yes and no. There were some parents that we can make some predictions. That was not essentially the goal. The goal is, yes, these models can sometimes be useful to gain some short-term understanding, but sometimes they can be misleading too, and you have to be aware of those, okay? Well, we don't know what program the Center for Disease Control was using, but they predicted that by January, I don't know if you remember the newspapers article, there's gonna be 500,000 cases, right? And then this journal, Business Times, or whatever it is, they said, we don't understand. By this day, there is so many cases, and is that here? These guys in Arizona, they said that there's gonna be about 7,000 cases by the end of September. We don't know how it can grow that much, you know, according to these reports. And I still don't know how much could be, how much it could go. But even this number, we thought it was high, right? And the reason it was high, because I told you, is the higher the reproductive number, the more cases, the bigger the curve. But as I told you before, with time, it's supposed to decrease. I'm gonna skip this one because I already told you that. But now, we're gonna do this. Actually, we published it in, also put a little note in Siam, in case you are members of Siam. And this was essentially we choose 10 points, and when we fit curves every 10 points, and then we actually were able to estimate the rate of exponential rise using some simple but techniques that you have to be careful. And eventually, we found out that the rate of growth was increasing. So this was different. I had not seen that. And the question why it was decreasing, and I think it has to be because they sent the soldiers, surrounded the towns, and said people can live. Okay. And that way they created more cases. Okay, so that was one of the first things. The second thing that we actually studied is the impact of technology. So this is another student of mine, Diego Chavez. He just published a paper in the Proceedings of National Academy of Sciences, that's incredibly hard, on cancer. In his free time, he came and said, Carlos, I have this idea to tell why he came. All of these guys came from my undergraduate program. I know them forever. So his idea, he came and he said, I have this idea. He's now was working on cancer. He knows a lot more about biology, certainly in cancer than I know. And he said, there is some PCR test, and this is polymerase chain reaction. And essentially, they applied them to 24 people without symptoms that have been exposed to Ebola. Of those 24, 11 actually developed symptoms. And of those, the tests have predicted that 7 of those would actually have Ebola. So in other words, with PCR, not right after people get infected, but after some time, we might be able to test, yeah, whether a person actually has Ebola before he can pass it. So that sounds great, right? That sounds wonderful. Okay, so that's what we did. So we wrote a simple model. So we have people that have no Ebola but not, cannot be detected, then detectable, then with symptoms, hospitalized, recover or death. So that's the general idea. And we write some equations, and we try to predict what happens if we actually are able to detect some people. Now, you detect people with Ebola, and you don't want that person to pass the Ebola, you have to isolate it. You have to put it somewhere, right? So, and it has to be effective. So, this was the proportion of selected individuals diagnosed before they had symptoms. So the proportion is 5, 10, whatever percent, right? Up to 50%. And in this case, essentially, is how effective was the isolation. So you see, if you are able to isolate effectively, let's say, what is the blue one? 50%, that's the blue one. If you are able to find place for 50% of them effectively, you see that it doesn't matter. It doesn't make any difference. You could have all the technology that you want, it doesn't make any difference, right? This is a very important message, right? It says you can't just provide technology. You have to provide where to isolate people. You have to provide decent places where they can take them. We have to have doctors. They have to provide different services. Otherwise, it doesn't work. Now, some of you are interested in Zika. So what is the relation to this, right? We have all these children being born with problems. Some people are terrified, as they should. Well, is that the only disease that causes that problem? Are there other diseases that at this time are creating much more birth defects than Zika? Anybody? Measles. Hundreds of thousands of people are born with birth defects because of measles. Do we have the technology to stop measles?
Yep.
Have you been vaccinated against measles? Yes, we have it. So why do we have hundreds of thousands of cases around the world when we have a vaccine? For Zika, there is no vaccine, but we have a vaccine. So these are issues that are important to address, and why addressing the problem at different levels of organization. Okay, I found the vaccine. Well, that's great. Now how we distribute it, now how we implement it, now how we provide places to isolate people. It's not just that. It's just not the technology. It's a lot more. Okay, so let me tell you a little bit about travel, see if I can have time to do this. But in this case, talk a little bit about influenza. And you see globalization. So this is straight from the Russian Empire. So influenza virus went with the train. It's a very clever virus. Okay? They invented the trains. So okay, I don't have to pay. So jump in the trains. It was a big hit. Okay. Then it came to the airplanes. So it jumped to the airplanes, right? And there is nothing that Trump can do about this. There is an issue here, and this is important because it's something that we forget about. This is that biology is not simple, and if we don't learn enough evolutionary biology, whether you are a mathematician or not, if we don't learn enough about evolutionary biology, we are sort of writing models, shooting blanks. So there has to be some. So people say, well, you know, that's so, no. You have to learn biology, and the problem is, not many of you are in interdisciplinary program, is that you actually have to learn. If you don't feel like this urgent need to read some articles on evolutionary biology, well, you are going to be asking people to tell you what is important, and if they make mistakes, which most likely they will make, you are going to work in some things that nobody cares. So let me give you an advice that was given to me by Stuart Kaufman, who's a doctor that worked with him when I was a postdoc. He said, Carlos, let me give you a piece of advice. He said, okay, Stuart, what is the piece of advice? And I say, never work in problems that people don't care. Never work on problems that people don't care. He said, you spend the same amount of time, so why should we work on problems that nobody cares? I, for example, have been working all my life on the origin of life. Now, do we care about that? Yes. That's a good problem. Has he found the answer? No. But that's a good life. So in this particular case, what I want to show you, this influenza epidemic, so you can think of the United States as a superorganism. Right? And these are different portions. So influenza virus attacks that areas. So what happens, there is exponential growth and then depletion of susceptibles in Gaza. Next year, it changes. And the next year, in this particular case, a cousin of this one comes. If it's a very close cousin, it's going to be very difficult for that cousin to go through the same area because the immune system is going to protect that part of this superorganism. If it is a distant cousin, it doesn't matter. Now next year, some close cousin came, and this happened. They had to follow a different path. Okay. This is why you use mathematical models. So I developed, when I was a postdoc, a theory of cross-immunity to address these issues, which is, was not different to the kinds of things that we were talking today, Mahid, about this ratio. Where's Mahid? I lost him now. About this ratio, which is not difficult. Okay. Waves. I want to talk about waves because we as mathematicians are in love with waves. And I must admit that I have written some papers proving existence of traveling waves just because it was hard and interesting, and because waves are interesting. It's not just stability and things like that. So this is the data on the influenza pandemic in Mexico. Okay. So it started in April, started around here. 2009, and here at this moment they decided to close the schools, football stadiums, professional games without customers. Mexico City was the cleanest city in the world. They separated the tables, everything was clean. Okay. Eventually, people realized, well, it's not so bad. Then more cases, then the summer came, went down, then school starts, goes up. So many people write papers, spatial-temporal dynamics of influenza. And they hit models, and they have data, and they do this routinely. Is this such a case? The answer is no. This is the epidemic of influenza. And you're going to see, you're going to appear in Mexico, and you're going to tell me, oh, how quickly it went to Canada, and then suddenly it's going to appear in Spain. That's not a traveling wave. Right? Can possibly follow this as a diffusion system. And yes, there are other ways, maybe there, but just not that. Now, I'm an expert on that, let's say. I'm not. I know a little bit, enough. That's all I know. So I'm going to apply that to this. And I'm going to, and you can get it. But why would you want to do that if you want to address a real problem? So what do we need to do this? And this is an important question. And that's the problem of doing applied mathematics, is that you learn something and then, oh, to do this, I have to learn something else. And that's the problem. Part of the solution is you work with somebody that knows that. And then they teach you. And the other way, and you form teams. And then when you come for evaluation, say, but you don't know too much about that or about that, you know, you should not get there. Say, but I solve an important problem. Say, who cares? No, I hope not. So we decided to use networks, right? And the networks we have, this is the most important city in the world, Mexico City. And then we have data on all the transportation flow from city to city. Okay. And this is, so you got Tlaxcala, you got here, Southern Terminal, you take the subway that transports 6 million people, you go to the other side, et cetera, et cetera. And the question, can this transportation network explain that? And there has been work on that area. The Russians did it in the 60s with the trans transportation. And they were very worried that their discoveries might be used to in biological work. Okay. And many other people have worked on those. And the model is as simple as that. You know, we have 32 states in Mexico. Okay. So within state dynamics, you have people that are not infected, infected, you have people that get hospitalized, people that recover, and in that case, there was still a vaccine, so maybe we can vaccinate them. And then you have transportation, and as I just have said, vaccination. So you can write equations for that. And then this is the data collected by states at different dates. And what appears in the graph that I showed you is the sums. And the sums is what gives you this kind of wave. So it's a function of the collection of the data, right? And then what we have to do, right, is what we have to, when we model the transportation, we have to scale it by population size. And then this Mexico City, which is this one and this one, that's all Mexico City, is over 22 million people, and then the other ones. And those in dark are the strongly connected parts, that's where more traffic is from Mexico City. And the other ones are the weakly connected parts of the network. So, weakly connected, strongly connected. Then we talked to some anthropologists, a particular anthropologist, Acuña Soto, great anthropologist. He has been looking at the certificates of death of people for many, many years, and who has died of pneumonia. And there is a lot of deaths of pneumonia on these areas, which is typically associated with influenza. So he called that the influenza corridor. It matches the strongly connected area. Okay. And then we develop a model. I'm going to skip because it's complicated and I want to speak when you more about it, run out of time. And we try and try and try and we couldn't. This is the best we have. This is the strongly connected states. This is the weakly connected. This is the sum. We don't get these three things. So I said, well, okay, this doesn't work. What else? How can I generate that data? Okay. And then we remember, well, there was interventions. Schools closing, people start losing fear, the summer school openings. So what if we alter the transmission based upon that? And that the top one is the transmission. First is very high, then it goes down because the school closing, then starts to recover different levels, then goes down because of the summer, and then starts to go up again when the schools open up. And if we do that, we can generate the patterns. Okay? And the first one, Mexico City is the big contributor, later the strongly connected, then the weakly connected, and then both of them together. And we generate the pattern. Hitting the data specifically, now we can do it, but that became irrelevant. Okay, I think I run out of time, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so I have another time, but what I'm gonna talk just is one thing is we're talking about, I've done a lot of theoretical work on contacts and how people transmit the disease. I probably written the most papers on that. So now I don't like it. Okay. Intellectually, it makes sense, right? But then I start asking questions. I have my friend from India, my former state, and I say, if you are in there, how many contacts do you have per unit time? Or you are using this transportation, how many contacts have you per unit time? And there are theory, and there are people that measure things, and I'm sure anybody has measured that one. So this is the kind of intellectually compelling data, observational data, that makes no